One major limitation of CMOS is the fact that it allows a short circuit current to pass between supply and ground. This seems counter to the nature of CMOS, to the very nature of CMOS, but let me explain why this current flows and why it is very dangerous. So let's begin by drawing a CMOS inverter, and let's ask ourselves what assumptions we have made so far while calculating the delay of this inverter. We have made so many assumptions, but actually one of the most dangerous assumptions we have made is that V input is a perfect step, that it has a perfect input slope. This is very unrealistic. Why am I sure that this is never going to happen? Because the input to any CMOS gate is an output from another CMOS gate. We always assume that the input to a gate from a logic family comes from a gate from the same logic family. And so the input to the CMOS gate is going to be the output of another CMOS gate. And my output in turn is going to be the input of another gate. And so how can you say, how can you guarantee, how can you imagine that this output is going to have a sharp slope? If the output has a finite slope, which we spent a lot of time calculating because it is simply propagation delay, then the input is also going to have a slope. And so now the question is, what does the fact that the input voltage have a slope, how does it affect delay, and does it have any other like implications on power dissipation, for example? And so to understand how this works out, we're going to draw a sketch of the input. And the input in this case is going to have a finite slope. So the input is going to be something like this. It's going to start at zero, and then it's going to rise to VDD, and it's going to have a finite slope, and then it's going to drop to zero again. So this is a more realistic V input. It's piecewise linear, but it's also more realistic than the step. In response, the output is going to drop. So the output is going to drop from VDD down to zero, and it's going to take some time, and it's going to take more time to settle than the input took to settle. And when this drops, the output is also going to rise again, right? Now, here's the problem. With the input having a finite slope, there is a range of time where both MN and MP are on. Now, above V threshold N, the input causes the NMOS transistor to be on. Below VDD minus V threshold P is an absolute value. The input voltage allows the PMOS to be on. And so for this range of time, both transistors are on, right? So why did this not happen before? When we looked at the CMOS inverter before, whether we were calculating the V output high or V output low, or whether we were doing delay, we never assumed that there are two transistors on at the same time. Recall, we only drew the PMOS charging the capacitor, or the NMOS discharging the capacitor. So why did this happen? This happened before because we assumed that the input was a perfect step. And if it is a perfect step, then as it turns on the NMOS, it will cut off the PMOS completely, and vice versa. Now, it is not a perfect step, and so there's a range where both transistors are on. Actually, if you recall the VTC for the CMOS inverter, there is a range where the two transistors are on, right? There's a range where both were ohmic. There's a range where one was ohmic and the other was sat, and there's a range where they were sat ohmic instead of ohmic sat. So it makes sense that both will be on at the same time. Why is this a problem? This is a problem because we always assumed that I flowing in the capacitor is equal to either IN or IP. When discharging, we assumed that the capacitor current IC was equal to IN fully. When charging, we assumed that the capacitor current IC was equal to IP fully. But now, if we look at the KCL with both the NMOS and the PMOS on, we find that IC is equal to IP minus IN. And therefore, because both are on at the same time, this decreases the net current that is available to charge or discharge the capacitance. Notice that this is a transient effect because eventually V input does rise up to VDD or does drop down to zero, thus fully switching off the transistor that we did not want to be on. However, this transient effect is important. In fact, it's so important that it's actually more critically important in a certain sub-range of this range. Because notice that the output also drops as the input rises. And so there is a range of the output where the two transistors are not only on, but where their drain potential is at such a uniquely intermediate position that both of them are saturated at the same time. And so this is a very dangerous range. It's a sub-range of this range where both transistors are saturated. Why is this a dangerous range? Because when the two transistors are saturated, their saturation currents are actually pretty much almost equal. This is especially true if we size the transistors so that TP high low is equal to TP low high. When they are both saturated, their currents are not a function of the output node because they are not a function of the drain. And thus, their currents are almost equal, which means that they are not providing any current to the capacitor. They're not discharging or charging the capacitor at all. Instead, they're giving it zero current. And so for this subrange, we don't actually have any current performing any charging or discharging. And so this effect, the effect of this current, is that it increases delay because we have to wait for this to subside before we can start calculating the TP high low and the TP low high that we have already calculated in previous videos. But it also means another thing. It means that now the PMOS and the NMOS, they provide a path from supply to ground. So this path from supply to ground means that a current, a saturation current, flows all the way from supply to ground. This is similar to the steady state power that was dissipated in ratio logic. And so we have to account for this kind of power dissipation. So basically we are looking at I, and let's call it I short circuit. This is the current that manages to pass from supply to ground, the current that is not providing anything useful to the capacitor. This current will only flow in this range and will only be particularly dangerous in this sub-range. And it will rise and drop again. But similarly, on the other side, in the sub-range where both transistors are saturated, this current will rise and drop again. And it will rise to a maximum value of ISAT. And this happens when both transistors are saturated and providing absolutely no current to the output capacitor. Again, this is a transient situation that will eventually resolve, but it is dangerous. So why is this bad again? Because it increases delay, but also because it is power dissipation. We are drawing power from supply and this power is going nowhere. It's not being stored in the capacitor. It is just current that is flowing through resistors and going to ground. This is power dissipation. And so how do we calculate this power dissipation? Again, we calculate the energy dissipated during each of these events. So we have event one and event two. And let's calculate the energy dissipated in event one, for example. So in event one, the energy dissipated is going to be power drawn from supply, and it is integrated over time, right? So it's going to be equal to the area under the curve, under this triangle, which is the average current that we provide, times the value of the supply. So it's going to be ISAT over 2 times supply times TSC, which is the amount of time, this amount of time, in which both transistors provide a short circuit between supply and ground. And so this is the amount of energy that we draw from the supply during event one or event two. The total amount of energy we draw for the two transitions is equal to ISAT times VDD times TSC, which is just this amount multiplied by 2. If it's not clear why this is energy, then think of it this way. The average power we draw is the average current multiplied by the voltage. This is the average current and this is the voltage. We're going to multiply this by the time that we took to draw this power, which is TSC, to give us the average energy. So this is the amount of energy drawn during the two transitions. And the two transitions happened They're going to repeat again after a period T capital until we see the other rising edge. And so the average power is going to be equal to E dissipated divided by the time period T capital. And so it's going to be I sat times VDD times TSC over T capital, which is I sat times VDD times F times TSC. Now, if you look at dynamic participation, it was equal to alpha C VDD square F. And if we compare these two power dissipation mechanisms to each other, we find that they are both functions of the supply voltage. They are both functions of the operating frequency, but that the short circuit current is not a function of capacitance. In fact, because short circuit current is a phenomenon that bypasses the capacitor completely. The other thing to notice is that apparently dynamic power is a stronger function of supply voltage because it is a quadratic function of supply voltage. Whereas short circuit power, this PSC, is only a linear function of supply voltage. But this is very misleading because ISAT, the saturation current, is itself a function of supply voltage. In fact, it is a quadratic function of supply voltage. And so P short circuit is a cubic function of supply voltage. It's an extremely strong function of supply voltage. It's important to notice what factors affect each method of power dissipation because this is how we try to combat these mechanisms.